join your mic with mic. Any questions? Okay, thank you, madam. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, madam. Okay, ma'am. Next thing. Bansiwal,
yeah, I'm already online. Am I audible?
Yeah, yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yeah.
Am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Voice is clear?
Yes.
It is clear.
Yes, it's audible, sir.
Okay. So,
please go ahead.
Okay. Yeah, so, sir, very good afternoon. Yeah.
Sir, I'll just have a brief introduction, or you can give your own introduction. See, now I invite Dr. Amit Bansiwal, Principal Scientist and Head, EMD Division, NIRI, from Nagpur, to deliver his lecture on carbon capture, utilization and sequestration. Please welcome Dr. Amit Bansiwal. So you can introduce in brief yourself, please, sir.
Okay. First of all, very good afternoon to you all. And I'm very grateful to the organizers for providing this opportunity to present myself and present before you glimpses of my work and related aspects in front of this August gathering. So I am, as mentioned by madam, I am Amit Bansiwal. Actually, there is little correction in the credentials, like I am presently heading the Sophisticated Environmental Analytical Facility and Business Development Group here at CSIR NIRI. NIRI is a National Environmental Engineering Research Institute, a constituent laboratory of CSIR. Our main focus of work is related to environmental engineering and environmental aspects. We work almost on every aspect related to environment, and which includes like air pollution control, water and wastewater management, solid and hazardous waste management, and lot of related area. So I'm sure all of you must be aware of the NIRI's activities. I will not go much into that detail. I am here in NIRI in Nagpur since almost last 20 years and working in the area of development of materials for energy and environmental applications. Mainly, you can broadly classify as environmental nanotechnology and sophisticated instrumentation. So this was all about my profile and my related work experience. So what today I'm going to share, in fact, today is World Environment Day, and I extend my heartfelt greetings to all of you on this auspicious day. Since we in NIRI celebrated it with lot of events, that's why I couldn't join earlier. So this is a very important day for us, and it reminds all of us to contribute a little bit for the betterment of the environment. And this particular webinar is a significant step, or rather significant effort in that direction. And I must congratulate the organizers for this particular event, organizing this particular event. So coming back to topic of my today's talk, which is related to carbon capture and sequestration. Basically, maybe can I share the slides? That will be better for all of us.
Yes, sir, please share.
Yeah, just a minute, I'm sharing. So my slides are visible.
Sir, this is visible.
Okay. So as I mentioned, I am going to discuss about carbon capture and utilization and sequestration. Basically, it is very much in line of theme of today's webinar, that is waste management. And you will be very exciting to know that CO2, which we are continuously dumping into the environment since the advent of the human civilization, is nothing but a global waste. Because if you go by layman's language of a waste, anything which is more than the assimilative capacity of the nature, or in more simpler words, any amount which nature itself cannot handle becomes a waste. So this fits into this particular definition of a waste. And since nature, the assimilative capacity of nature for handling the CO2, which is being emitted in large quantities globally, has already exhausted a centuries ago. So we are actually continuously dumping this waste in terms of gas into the atmosphere, and this is a very, very crucial and a matter of concern for the entire mankind, because survival of the future generation is in question because of this particular dumping of the waste CO2 gases, or the global warming gases, into the atmosphere. So this topic is very, very important and crucial to discuss. And what I'm going, considering the wide variety of audience, I will not go into much into the details or the minor technical details. I will present a brief overview of this particular area, and any one of you can contact personally or through this platform to further discuss that. So as I was mentioning, this is nothing but a waste disposal problem. The global warming is nothing but a waste disposal problem, because globally we emit about 36 billion tons of CO2 per year, and it is continuously increasing. And as we all know about the greenhouse gas effect and the global warming, every one of us are aware of it. It has resulted in increasing the Earth's temperature, and it's a matter of great, great concern for all of us. So there was a Paris Convention also for this, and there are several targets defined in that convention that temperature should not increase by more than 2 degrees by 2050. This is one of the very ambitious target which all the countries have agreed upon, and it is rather, there is no option except to fix such targets and do something to prevent the survival of future generations. So obviously we have to reduce the emissions of the CO2, control the emissions of the CO2, and probably work on reduction of CO2 concentration in the atmosphere. And as I mentioned, this is a very ambitious target, and you can see the graph on the right side that if we continue with the current policy, the blue one, we will reach a maximum of 60 billion tons of CO2 per year. But if we work on the mitigation measures and implement some mitigation or solutions into the our industry and the emitting sources, we are likely to get some reduction in the emissions, and which ultimately result in the reduction in the global warming. So this is how which has been planned and targeted for this particular contaminant. However, the entire world fraternity is agreed that world is not on track to meet its agreed target of limiting 2 degree warming to by 2050. And if the current policies and technologies will continue, then we'll ultimately end up in the range of between 3.1 to 3.7. So the whole idea is that we have to very aggressively work on this particular area and come out with more feasible technological solutions. So what is the problem? So let us first see or diagnose what exactly is the problem before looking for the solution. So I will actually, I am directly taken this screenshot from a global observatory, Mauna Loa, that which is continuously measuring CO2, the global and local CO2 concentration since 1970. And you can see the data, recent data on the left side of the graph from 2016 to 2020. It's continuously increasing. And you see the red curve is the actual measurements, and the central black line is the moving average of the concentrations. The cyclic pattern you see is because in winters during November, December, there is fall in the CO2 concentrations, and it again regain in the summers and other seasons. So this is how this fluctuating pattern is there. But if you see the average, it's continuously increasing. And this green box shows the most recent data. It was updated on May 5, 2020. And you can compare the values with a gap of 1 year. Like in February 2019, we were at 410.09 ppm of global CO2 average concentrations, whereas in February 2020, it almost increase of more than three ppm of CO2 concentration has increased in 1 year itself. So you can imagine how continuously we are increasing and dumping the CO2 into the atmosphere. If you go a little more back in the historic data from 1980, the curve shown at the right side, it again shows the continuous increase. In 80, we were at 340 ppm, and today we have almost passed 410 ppm of ambient CO2 concentration. So this is the problem. Let us go more deep into the history, or more backward in the history. If you see the figure at the left hand side, the data from 1700 century to present data is shown here. And this clearly shows the impact of the Industrial Revolution, which started in 1920 or so, which resulted in exponential increase in the CO2 concentrations post-Industrial Revolution. And more worrisome for us that India is also a significant emitter or contributor for the CO2 emissions. As you can see, this orange one I am marked with red arrow. We are almost third or fourth in the rank of major contributors. So this is a point of worry for us, and we have to do something. Scientists actually create miracles, because they have even very reliable data of 8 lakh years back, means 8 lakh year BCE. They measured the CO2 concentration through the ice core measurements, like the air bubbles trapped in the historic ice in the South Pole and North Pole. So they dig out the cores, and from the depth of the core, they determine the age, and from that ice core, the air trapped of that era in the ice core were measured for the CO2 concentrations, and they have almost a reliable data of very long past historic data. So you can see in ice ages, it was around 185 ppm. Pre-industrial era was having 278 ppm, and in 1979 January, it reached 336 ppm, and in 2019 we are at 411 ppm. So this is how CO2 is being continuously dumped into the atmosphere, and has resulted in the increase in the concentrations, and which ultimately has resulted in the map also shows the distribution of CO2 emitting sources. The more bright, it is a very huge modeling exercise which combine use of space-based nighttime light data and individual power plant emissions or location profiles, and which estimate the fossil fuel CO2 emissions to a resolution of 1 by 1 kilometer. So you can see a very high resolution data of CO2 emitting sources, and you can see very brightly shining India is there, which is also a matter of concern that we have a lot of CO2 emitting sources. As far as per capita CO2 emissions are concerned, we are little means we are comfortable because per individual we emit much less, but if we multiply it with the population, it almost reach the values much higher than many other countries. So per capita is okay, but total emissions of a country like India is very, very high. So we have established the problem of CO2, the increasing concentration, and are there any solutions, because it's a very long problem and we are looking for some, the present generation is struggling to find some solution. Yes, there are some solutions and solution is carbon capture and sequestration. Basically, we have to stop the emissions of CO2 and store it for long terms. That is the only solution, and there are several options for that which I will share in my subsequent slides. So this slide shows the sector wise CO2 emissions. As you see, the industry and power generation are the major sources of CO2, which power at the top, about 25% emissions, and industry at 21%. So this power and industry together contributes about 50% of the CO2 emissions, and among industry also major contributors are iron and steel, cement manufacturing, chemicals and waste management and all. And also transport contributes significant towards the CO2 emissions, and there are natural and agricultural sources and some other sources. So this help us in defining our like approach to where to actually attack to stop or to reduce the emissions, whether it is industry or the power. So it is clearly evident that if we start with controlling CO2 emissions in power sector and industrial sector, it can make a significant impact. So as I mentioned, the probable solutions are carbon dioxide capture and sequestration, which is a process consisting of separation of CO2 from industrial and energy related sources, transport it to a storage location, and long-term isolation from the atmosphere to stabilize the atmospheric greenhouse gas concentration. So this is the definition given by IPCC. And besides CCS, there are other options also, like improving the energy efficiency, switching to less carbon intensive fuels, the nuclear power, renewable energy, enhancement of biological sinks of this CO2, like a lot of plantation can help us in sequestering a lot of CO2. So these are probable other options, but all have to be followed parallelly if we want to achieve really impactful outcomes. So what includes carbon capture and sequestration? There are primarily three verticals or three important branches of this CCS. One is CO2 capture, another is CO2 storage, and third one may be value addition or converting CO2 to value added product. So CO2 capture includes selective capture of CO2 from large point sources, basically the power plants and the industry, the large fossil fuel or biomass energy facilities, and CO2 emitting industries. Storage can include geological storage, the oceanic storage, and fixation of CO2 into as carbonate, which is termed as mineral carbonation. I will share more details. And then value addition, like CO2 can act as a raw material or feedstock for a variety of chemicals, but this is not expected to contribute much for the reduction of CO2, because converting it itself requires a lot of energy, and it will not be a permanent storage, because the chemical which we are preparing from CO2 as a raw material will be again used and will again release CO2 into the atmosphere. So it will not be a permanent fixation. So I will discuss one by one and little in detail. CO2 capture can be achieved using four approaches. One is like industrial separations, post-combustion CO2 capture, pre-combustion CO2 capture, and oxy-fuel combustion. the concentration of CO2 in the gas stream, the pressure of the stream, and the type of fuel are important factors which help in selecting one of the capture option among the above four. So what is post-combustion CO2 capture is like when fuel and air are burned, it releases flue gases containing CO2. Then we have a CO2 separation unit after the combustion, which separates CO2 from other gases and from in the flue gases, and it can be pure stream of CO2 can be prepared for further sequestration. Pre-combustion CO2 capture is like the fuel and the air and oxygen are mixed along with the hydrogen, and which ultimately results in the generation of energy through hydrogen and air, and the pure CO2 stream is available for further sequestration before it is released into the atmosphere. And oxy-fuel combustion is like it is a cyclic operation of the fuel in which high concentration oxygen stream is supplied along with the fuel, which resulted in the cycling or the conversion of complete combustion, which actually result in complete combustion, so that other gases do not emerge out of the stack. So I will discuss more detail of these post combustion capture, which can again be of three or four types, like absorption, adsorption, membrane separation, and cryogenic separation. Because this is the mature technology which has been implemented in the field. So post combustion CO2 capture can be achieved using solvent based CO2 capture, wherein like basically in industry amine is used for capturing CO2 or scrubbing CO2, and then saturated amine is heated to release the pure stream of CO2. This is the only technology which is being practiced at industrial scale as on today. Then we have solid adsorbent or porous sorbents, membranes, and hybrid system also, which includes combination of the liquid and solid absorbents and adsorbents. So these are the four types of capture systems. Considering the time limitations, I am relatively rushing the slides because we have to keep the timeline in mind. But if you have anything to say, you can contact me. So this is just glimpse of some of the work which we have done in our laboratory, like the conventional amine which are used for capture of CO2 have several limitations, like the energy requirement for regeneration is very high, they are very corrosive, their degradation is a problem. So we tested some biogenic molecules for capture of CO2, and which proved to be very selective. They are thermally stable and non-corrosive and non-volatile, and most importantly, their efficiency is much higher than the conventional amine, as you can see in this graph, wherein we compared with the monoethanol amine, which is the conventional amine used for capture of CO2. And the energy requirement for releasing CO2 is also very less as compared to the conventional system. So this is just what we are doing in our laboratory. And we are establishing a pilot system of almost a full-scale system in thermal power plant nearby Nagpur. So coming to the this, what I have mentioned till now is about capture. Now coming to the sequestration and utilization. As I mentioned, there can be four pillars of sequestration: the geological sequestration, the conversion to chemicals and fuels, oceanic or terrestrial sequestration, and fixing in building materials or as mineral carbonates. Each one of the sequestration method is having their own advantages and disadvantages. As the blue arrow shows the limitation associated with each of the approach, like conversion of chemical, as I mentioned, is not a permanent fixation. The oceanic sequestration has their environmental aspects is not yet fully understood, and it's not yet established that it is safe, environmentally safe in long run. Similarly, the geological sequestration, it is relatively in more advanced stage as compared to other options, particularly in the abundant mines and the use of CO2 for enhanced oil recovery. Basically, they inject CO2 into the oil wells, which results in better yield and enhanced yield of the fuel. So, as I was mentioning, one of the options is conversion of CO2 to materials, wherein CO2 is used as a raw material. And you can see in this figure that there are enormous possibilities, like food and food products, the carbonated beverages, the conversion using biological route through algae and other microbes also results in fuel and food products. The CO2 can be used as an extractant for flavors and fragrances. Mineralization, like as I mentioned, mineral carbonations of the metal oxides, conversion, a huge variety of chemicals can be prepared using CO2. Like methanol, urea, hydrocarbons, because it's a major source of carbon basically. The refrigerant, dry ice, like CO2 ice, every one of us must have used in the laboratory. And several other options are there. So electrochemical and photoelectrochemical conversion is one of the major area. Lot of researchers are working for converting CO2 to value-added chemicals using electrochemical and photoelectrochemical approach. Basically, photoelectrochemical is more of a preferred choice because it uses the solar energy, which is a renewable source of energy. So we can also use CO2 for mineral carbonation, wherein the reaction of CO2 with metal oxide is explored. And these metal oxides are abundantly available in nature, and many of them are also available as industrial waste, like slags and the sludges. They all lot of ore and mineral processing industry, they produce lot of metal oxides which are waste for them. So those can be carbonated using CO2 and can be used for building construction, road construction, and other such activities. CO2 can also be used for curing of the concrete and conversion of slags to building aggregates. This is about geological sequestration. I have already mentioned it can be injected into saline formations for enhanced oil recovery and also the oceanic sequestration. Technologies developed by oil and gas industry has proven to be economically feasible and is exploited at larger scale. Enhanced oil recovery is particularly in advanced stage, and it requires specific conditions for oil and gas field and saline formations. However, its storage of CO2 in unminable coal bed is still not yet fully established. So this figure shows the overall scenario of the several technological options available for carbon capture and sequestration. They are TRL level, the technology readiness level from 1 to 3, the 9, we can consider TRL 9 is considered as fully deployed in the field and commercial system. So the blue one are for technologies related to CO2 capture, the orange one for transportation, the green dot circles are for storage, and purple are for utilization. So mainly the capture technologies, as I mentioned, the post-combustion capture using amine is in advanced stage. Similarly, transportation using pipeline is already an established technique, and storage in saline, deep saline aquifers, and enhanced oil recovery are the major technologies which are in very, very advanced stage as of now. So I would like to summarize here my entire talk. The net reduction of emission to the atmosphere through CCS depends on because ultimately it should result in net sequestration of the carbon. So it depends on the fraction of CO2 captured, the increased CO2 production resulting from loss in overall efficiency of power plant or industrial processes due to the additional energy required for capture. So we have to consider all the factors. We should not forget that we are implementing a CO2 capture technology, which also require energy and energy means generation of CO2. So there should be a net gain in terms of CO2 sequestration. The transportation and storage of CO2 and any leakage should also be taken into consideration during transportation. The fraction of CO2 retained in storage over a long term is the only amount of CO2 which should be considered for a practical gain. So obviously, no single technological option will provide all the emission reductions needed to achieve the stabilization of CO2 concentrations. But a portfolio of mitigation measures will be needed for the greenhouse gases. Like I mentioned in the beginning itself, there are several options available, and a single option will not help us. We have to go for the renewable energy sources, the nuclear power, the carbon capture and sequestration, the biological sequestration. All the aspects have to be practiced parallelly and simultaneously to achieve the huge targets which are in front of us. So we have to go a long way, maybe not for us, but for the survival of our future generations. So let us pledge to work in this area, and let us as an individual reduce our carbon footprint. So that's all from my side. I have mentioned the email ID and phone number, mobile number here. You people can note it down and contact me. Feel free to contact whenever you feel to have more information on this topic.
Thank you, sir. We all know today there is a World Environment Day, and we know that for global warming, the very important gas is CO2. Now, by any method, if we are able to convert CO2 in some other environment-friendly form, then we'll be able to reduce global warming like anything. So this is a very good topic for our participants and for all of us. Carbon sequestration by various methods you mentioned, by carbon capture and many other methods. So they will be very useful, and the technology we have to apply.
Very important picture. Thank you, sir. Thank you so much.
Research is required to be done in this field. So thank you very much, sir. Thank you very much.
Thanks a lot, and looking forward for long-term association.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir.
Excuse me, sir.
Thanks, sir.
I want something. Hello.
The voice is not clear.
Can you hear me? I want to ask one question. Everybody know about glowing warming and about control them. Hi.
Hello.
ये जो अभी सर थे ना उनको बाद में स्टूडेंट्स कुछ पूछ रहे बंसीवाल सर अभी जो थे ना वो बाद में पूछ सकते हैं वैसे सी पार्टिसिपेंट्स कैन डिस्कस लेटर ऑन विथ डॉक्टर बंसीवाल सो लेट अस गो टू अवर नेक्स्ट स्पीकर कनेक्ट करना।